First of all, thank you so much for being here. Saturday is a day when a lot of people prefer to socialize, but you've stayed on to listen to a panel discussion on the Women in Cinema Collective and the Me Too movement. The fact that you're interested means a lot. I feel privileged to be moderating this discussion. Today is a special day because on May 18th, 2017, a very important photograph was published in the press across southern India, at least. It was a photograph of women like Rima. Were you in the picture?
Padmapriya? In the picture.
Okay. Manju Varier, Beena Paul, and a whole bunch of very eminent women of the Malayalam film industry meeting Pinarayi Vijayan. And that was the first public announcement of the formation of the Women in Cinema Collective in Kerala. This was, yes, so congratulations. It's a sort of anniversary. To my mind, WCC is a milestone in the Indian feminist movement at large. It is also an organization that has not got its due and also not got the space that it should have got in the media that calls itself the national media, the newspapers and TV channels based in Delhi and Bombay. And the reason why that's problematic is not just because, you know, it's not about giving certificates and credits and medals to people like Padmapriya and Rima. It's about building awareness, because when you're aware of what they're doing, you can offer solidarity and you can also be inspired. I believe that this is a movement that could have been and still has the potential to be a source of inspiration to women of India's film industries across the map. And of course, women of other professions. I have personally been covering them for the past 2 years and have found them extremely inspiring. So thank you, Rima and Padmapriya, for being here. Thank you, Jubith, for being a part of this panel. Because as women feminists, we depend on the support of gentlemen feminists. And it is obvious to anyone who has watched your film that gender is a big consideration in your life. So I'm going to ask a few questions and then we will open it to the audience. Rima, I think I'd like to start with you because you're the intersection of WCC and the film Aabhasam, which we've just seen. And I think one of the things that to me was important in Aabhasam was representation. It's not just the discussion on gender, but it went beyond just speaking about women. I think the fact that Jubith chose to cast a trans actor in the role of a trans person, instead of doing what most people do, which is to get a man to wear women's clothes, I thought that was very significant. How much do you think the fact that there are still not enough strong roles for women in films across India, but in the Malayalam film industry specifically, how much does that contribute to the limits of the power that women exercise over the industry, as a result of which there is, we know, discrimination, bias, and so on and so forth. Could you speak about that?
Hello, everybody. Good evening. Thank you for being here today, tonight. I think while we were traveling to Delhi today morning, we were discussing about a lot of movies that we watched as youngsters. And are there a lot of Malayalis here?
Yes.
Okay, so I was just talking about this movie called Miduna in Malayalam, where, you know, it's from a completely from a male's perspective. And there is this female character, the heroine character in the movie throughout, who doesn't really have any say, doesn't even have a scene to explain why she is behaving the way she's behaving. And I think she was completely cornered, and, you know, she was just left a spectator throughout the movie. And I think she is even made to apologize for whatever she did, even though she was just standing her ground. She was even made to apologize at the end of the movie. So I think we, a generation of Malayalam cinema can be remade from the heroine's perspective, because it would be a completely different movie altogether. And I think it's been quite a while that we, see, Malayalam cinema is known for its content. It's known for the brilliant cinema that's come out of the industry. But even in spite of all of that, I think representation, especially gender, is something that has been widely ignored. And to a large extent, I've been in the industry for 10 years. I think I was equally part of the system and the problem, because even I didn't know better. I really didn't, Anna. You know, when I look back, I'm thinking, why did it take 10 years for me to speak up? I guess I was part, I mean, I was equally conditioned, I was equally part of the system and the problem. So, and it took something like what happened to a bully to kind of shake us out of that stupor, you know, and we are like, oh, okay, suddenly. It did happen. So yes, I think it is very, very, so if you guys have seen this movie called Sudani from Nigeria, recently, it's a Malayalam movie, and it talks about a person from Malappuram, which is the north part of Kerala. And suddenly, this area, Malappuram, is represented from by a writer and director who comes from Malappuram. And the whole narrative changes. Till now, people from Malappuram were looked at, you know, with a filter. Suddenly, when two creative people who come from that space narrate a story of a man from that space, it completely changes the narrative. I think representing women and women being part of the creative process and the storytelling process is the only way we're going to, you know, start scratching at the surface of this problem.
Okay, so what is the way to increase representation? Padmapriya, I mean, we know that, of course, Rima is a producer. And a lot of people in Hollywood have found that a solution. Women, strong women who are big stars in Hollywood turning producers. But and yet in India we have very few women who turn producers. But is this a solution? Getting more, having more women turning producers, getting more women as directors, and more women as writers. Can this be seen as a solution, or is it just going to be women who will then, you know, take over the reins of power and still work against women?
I think it's part of the solution. I know a lot of, I think there's an entire spectrum of the whole demand supply movies, right? So I know a few female filmmakers who started off early on and still would like to have, and I move away from Rima's perspective of storytelling and say that it's not about having a female character or a strong male character, it's about having a strong story. It's about having diverse stories. And when you start talking about that, and place it in the midst of the kind of environment the current commerce of the cinema industry is made to look at, it's not necessarily what the audiences want. I mean, I genuinely don't think the Netflixes and the Amazons of the world, with even their disadvantages, could have been where they are in terms of content production, right? Like a GOT being made mainstream in Hollywood 10 years back would have been unimaginable. That they chart out about 600 odd movies over a period of 4 years is just amazing. And the kind of nudity, the kind of violence you see is not something we could have imagined even in Hollywood. What I'm trying to say is I think the commerce and the making of the cinema has to change as much. The perspective that women filmmakers and women producers get in, and the kind of sensitivity that definitely adds a lot, I can definitely say to that in terms of the process of filmmaking. When I was shooting for Chef, there were like at least 40% of women, not just at the top level, but from the, you know, from down the value chain, from the, you know, ADs to a runner to the art designer to the editor to the camera person. It was like a fair balance of representation. I can tell you, like, see, when you have a director like Raja on board, I could have a conversation with him and actually have a better character in Chef than the original fabulous Chef, primarily because you can have a conversation around that. So I think it's A, to get more representation of women helps build an environment ecosystem where there's possibilities like what you're talking about. But at the end, we will have to challenge the commerce and the mechanics of movie making. We need more people like him as well onboarded, where we can make diverse storytelling, like she said, about how do you represent a certain part of the country, a certain part of the state. I think that's equally important. When you start bringing diverse stories and you start having a diverse workforce, that's when you'll be able to make that little click of a change. Because this is not, WCC to me is not just about, you know, a reason why we threaten a lot of people. It's not because there are a bunch of 20 women saying, hey, give me equal opportunity. Yes, that too, which is our right. And I hope that our constitution remains and our forefathers and our hope for freedom and fraternity and liberty remains. But beyond that, it's questioning the very power mechanics and the commerce of the industry, the way it's visualized by the industry people. So when we talk about equal pay, people assume that we are the only ones out there. So as I was talking to you just before, there's a certain payment you pay a person for a skill, for the time that they put into that work, right? And that is also very questionable today. So when you start saying, okay, you draw contracts, you create parameters on which you're going to make payments, it's not just talking about equality for me, it's talking about equality for a man also who's striving to be there, and I'm sure I would like you to speak to that then. And it's that questioning that's managed by a few people in the industry and are willing to not let go of it. When I say few people, it does not mean a certain old set of people. I refer to the entire ecosystem of industry, young or old, who are part of that and who want to gain from that control and power, which kind of restricts not just equal rights, but equal participation, and hence what suffers is the audience who does not get the kind of diverse storytelling. Today, why does the e-market make it better for filmmakers? Because you suddenly have the space to attract that 1% of that audience which is willing to see that film. Every story has an audience, and you're creating that ecosystem for them. So until we move towards that ecosystem, along with a fair representation of varied kind of people, I don't think that shift is going to happen.
Well, the one thing you cannot accuse Aabhasam of is lack of representation. You know, as a journalist for the past 25 years, as a stuck record, I have repeatedly asked filmmakers, why are you not telling the stories of women? Why are you not telling the stories of Dalits? Why are you sitting in Bombay not naturally telling stories of South Indians, of Northeasterners? And they get defensive, and always the answer is, but shouldn't I tell the stories that come to me? Or are you saying I should sit down and say, today I'll make a woman-centric story? That's not the point. The point is, how is it that the stories of women and Dalits and Sikhs and Muslims who are all around us don't come to you naturally? So the question to you is, how did this story come to you naturally? Because I'm assuming you didn't sit down and say, I'm going to make a film where there's one transsexual and one Muslim and one Hindu and one Christian and one woman and one this. I'm assuming that was not the manner in which you work. So how did this story come to you naturally? How did this film come to you naturally? Is it about your upbringing, your environment? What is it?
Hello. Hello, everyone. Good evening. Thank you for being here. Hope you all like the movie.
Yes.
And this is my first film. So, you know, let me just go. Regarding the example that Rima just quoted, Midhunam. So Midhunam is a film that I enjoyed being a kid. I didn't understand what is so wrong in it. So it took me so many years to actually understand there's another side to it. And that's the evolution that I want to, you know, point to. That's the evolution of an artist, that's an evolution of a filmmaker. I want to quote a line from Kadamanita's poem. Not poem, it's a saying basically. It's an attempt to be a good human being that I'm being part of an art, or, you know, I practice art. It's an attempt to be a good human being. It's not that I'll become, it's just an attempt. I mean, I'm in the process of it. So various gray shades, that's what it is. So yeah, I'm a person who enjoyed Midhunam. I'm a person who enjoyed so many patriarchal bullshit. And it's been, you know, gradually over the time, I learned what's wrong in it. I learned what's wrong in my perspective, my grooming. I mean, it's with a new experience that you find out, okay, we have this thing in our mind. And then we, you know, make attempts to correct it on a neutral level. You attempt to correct it on a neutral level. And then you attempt to move on. You cannot move on without correcting it. If you leave that there, I mean, then all your art, all your work is going to have that. So, you know, it's like that. So it's a gradual attempt to, you know, sort out things one by one. So that's you know, regarding the film. So there are many films like that. So coming to Aabhasam, there was a film in 2010, a short film that I made called Democracy to Each His Own. It was a short film, 6 minutes. It was also a bus movie. basically the idea of that bus movie was to represent India as a whole inside a bus with, you know, all sorts of people. And that's a small budget and a short film. It clicked, it worked with people, it instantly connected with people. But then that was another psych altogether. I mean, a short film, 6 minutes, that's another psych. So, you know, I wanted to, that to, you know, be bought inside a film theater, you know, bought under a masquee, like, you know, bringing, you know, real actors into it, you know, bringing the audience to watch it in theater, and, you know, telling people that, you know, such films could be made. So that was an attempt towards it. How successful it was, it's something that you should tell me. So, so that's it.
Okay. I just want to ask a couple of questions about the Women in Cinema Collective to Padmapriya and Rima, and then I hope there'll be a mic going around the audience. You know, Rima, it's been 2 years. And the truth is that when I first heard about the Women in Cinema Collective, I thought you're not going to last for more than 6 months. Because I'm a regular viewer of Malayalam cinema, and I read some of the interviews that people of the Malayalam film industry give. And I know that it must have, I knew it would be a massive battle, and I thought you would get exhausted. Why is it that you have managed to persist for 2 years while the Me Too movement in the Hindi film industry, which gets far more media coverage, and you would imagine that that media coverage means power for the women in the industry, yet that Me Too movement in the Hindi film industry has fizzled out within just a few months. What is the secret of WCC's persistence?
I think first and foremost, I do maintain that it happened because it was in Kerala. This whole movement happened because we have a media, we have a society, we have a section of population who stood by us and who vocally supported us. I think the media, like, look at her. For 2 years, she's been on this, as in, she's been with us. It's wonderful the kind of support we got from the media. I think that was huge for us. And I think, I don't know, I think our society has a special kind of a fiber where a large number of people did stand up and say they have a point. We really didn't think that would happen. And we were like, wow, they all agree with us, wow. Okay, so you know that was a start. Another thing, I think, you know, I feel we're still around is because, see, when I thought of WCC, it was just pure frustration and maybe like all this internalized anger coming out. I've never really worked in an organization. I never really had student at college politics where I studied. I didn't know how to work in an organization and, you know, I didn't know the framework, nothing. But then we had people like a Padmapriya, we had a Veena Paul, we had a Sajda Madhatar, we had a Didi Damodaran, who you know, who are comrades, who have been there, done this, and you know, they could guide us. So we had people from different kind of backgrounds, different kind of bring, you know, experiences, different kind of strengths, and all of that put together kind of made such a dynamic, you know, environment for all of us to learn and grow, and it was so exhilarating at one point, you know, when we were on a roll, you know, we kept learning and understanding a lot of things in the process. And I think WCC, more than anything else, has been a journey of realization for myself. I think it has been a journey of realization of what privilege looks like and how privileged I myself am. I think that's what WCC has done the most for me. And understanding that, coming from such, sitting in such a privileged situation, I'm going through all of this, I can only imagine what's happening, you know.
In the larger, yeah.
And I think if we don't speak now, it'll be.
Can I add to what Rima said? I think there are a couple of very important points which kind of makes WCC a little bit, it's not like our fellow film industries haven't, right? So the Tamil film industries been doing things, the Telugu film industry in its own ways. But the journeys have been very different, primarily because of two, three things. One is that finally we saw one woman stand up for herself, courageously challenging the reality which all of us, honestly, which all of us in one way or the other face. And for us, that whole ability and that courage of that woman in many which ways stoked the courage in all of us. We really started off as a support group for that person. But then we realized, oh, this is, we are all in it. And you know, much before the Me Too movement broke down in the Hollywood, we were like, oh, this happened to you. Oh, literally, you were a kachacha in her dance school. The first time we met, we were like, oh, this happened to you. Oh, that happened to you. And Veena had once made a point, we knew each other for a decade. Why is this we never spoke about it? I knew her even before I entered cinema, before she entered films. We knew each other as dancers. And then we realized, oh, we know that the charter which you're talking about to the government was supposed to be only for one particular issue. Then we realized, oh, we have 25, 30 points at the minimum. And we were arguing the entire night to bring down 100 points to 20, 30 so it becomes manageable. What I'm trying to say is that there was this realization through one incident that this is not something which is one-off. B, unlike other industries, we kind of fended off on each other's energies a lot. So there are times when, honestly, I really had no strength, and then there was an Anjali come in, okay? There were times when Rima literally took the reins, and then the other person didn't. So the strength of the movement was larger than the sum of the individuals was larger than the individual themselves, which unlike, say, in Telugu or Tamil, to some extent in Karnataka that has been the case, but was not the scenario. So there was this strength that no matter how split our opinions, views, and beliefs are, the movement in many ways is larger, and no matter how dissipated our energy is, somebody is going to be stronger holding up the reins. And I think that's really, really important. Sometimes collectives can be very claustrophobic, but this for us has been a very learning experience to grow professionally and personally. The third most important thing is when we started realizing that we're losing our professionally, we provided enough space to each other at different points of time to let the other person flourish professionally as well. And I think that's a very important point. You can't assume that women's rights can happen to us, especially in this industry, if you are out of sight. And I think that's, apart from all the facts that she pointed out, makes us unique. And the last point is that we made sure, in a large way, I would say a big thank you to the government of Kerala, because unlike many other state governments, including Tamil Nadu, which is Chinmay, with all due respect, my differences of opinion with politics and governments, this was one government and this was one association which said that, okay, we're not going to have anybody supporting us. Somebody needs to go and do this for us. Who is that person? That's the GOK. So whether it's the small little fund, even if it's tokenism, the first time ever in India, it's happened abroad, has given fund for saying that films made by women has to come out. It's a brilliant second step for us, not the first step. I think Andhra government has reached the first step, which we started off with today. And so all of these things kind of put together kind of defines why WCC is celebrating its second year. And I hope we soon become non-existent, which is not going to happen. But yes, I think that would be the biggest success parameter.
Just adding one point to it. Aabhasam was connected to this Me Too movement, basically. Because one incident occurred in the set, and it was Divya Govindath that came out second in Me Too in Kerala, and Alan Sear was the guy who was standing opposite. So, okay, in case you don't know, if you have just watched the film, the lady in the Muslim couple, that's Divya Govindath, and the driver is Alan Sear. So we had an issue, Divya came out with Me Too. There was a second Me Too after Archana Patani, I guess. And so we stood by her. And what we understood in the process is, even though you come out with Me Too, you come out, you need to have a lot of courage to come out and say and tell the trauma you went through, that to public, not in your private space. And after all that, how the industry sidelines you is kick you out of all projects. You won't get any more projects. So there are filmmakers like producer Rima and filmmakers Rajiv Ravi, Ashik Kapoor, there are a lot of people who are taking efforts to bring them in back to the, you know, mainstream. So a big round of applause for them too. You know, it takes a lot.
Before we open up, a big applause to this filmmaker, because when Divya came up with this complaint and I was having a conversation on what are the options that he could have, and we were running around with lawyers, my first thing was, do you have a backup story, you know, like otherwise defamation, you know how it's been happening. So she said, yes, the director. I said, who's the director? And so I call and I speak to him and I say, okay, can you give me the director's number? And by the time I hung up from Divya, I got a message from him saying, I want to talk to you. And I was like, oh wow, this also happens. And then he calls me, because I only see the outside story with male filmmakers most of the times. And he calls me, and then I'm like, will you stand by your story? He said, yeah, of course, this is what happened. I was like, great, dude. So I think a big thank you, because even with a small percentage of the start. Thank you.
You know, because most of you are not Malayalis, and because, like I said, the media here has not covered WCC as it should, I want to briefly introduce WCC to you. In 2017, February, a very major actress in the Malayalam film industry was abducted and sexually assaulted for a few hours on a moving car. This woman, I mean, hats off to her, filed a police complaint. As a result of which, the investigations by the police revealed that one of the biggest superstars in the Malayalam film industry, Dilip, was the prime conspirator in her abduction and assault, because he had certain personal issues with her. For that woman to have gone and filed that police complaint, knowing what a big name she is, first of all, I bow to her. Secondly, Rima, I think, is a good friend of hers. And the reason why WCC started off was, as they pointed out, it was a sort of support group for her. And when they started talking to each other, they realized each of them had experiences that they hadn't even spoken about to each other. So it's in February, I think, informally you had formed, but Pinarayi Vijayan had a meeting with them. And the fact that, and they're right, the Kerala government seems to have been extremely supportive. When Parvati was being abused and threatened with rape by Mammootty fans because she spoke up against an extremely misogynistic film of his, the finance minister of Kerala gave such a strong speech in support of her. So, Rima, you're right. I may be in Malayali, but I live in Delhi, and I know that whatever the flaws of Kerala might be, the state that you live in, the way the politicians supported you, the public, and the solidarity of the women in your industry, hats off to you for that. Is there a mic? Is there anyone in the audience who would like to ask questions? Because I have 50 questions.
And I can go on.
Yes, so
there's...
Oh, okay. Sajan? Is there someone here who wants to ask a question? Yeah, there's a gentleman there, yes.
Did you get any support from Amma, the Association of Malayalam Movie Artists, in this? What was their response?
Does the member who resigned want to speak?
Yeah, I resigned from Amma because...
No, I mean, there was no support. Like, to be plain frank, three fools like me, Parvati and Revati went to have a conversation with them.
They should know what happened
before that.
So basically, after 80 days in jail, when Dilip came out, they immediately revoked his ban and took him back into Amma, even though the case had not even started. And we spoke to them. We said, considering our friend is, you know, watching everything that's happening, and you know, she. Justice is not served, at least we really don't know what's happening anymore. Don't you think you should wait till the case is over before you can take him back? And nothing happened. And me, along with Ramya Nambishan and Geetu Mohandas, and the artist who was assaulted, we had to resign to make a point. And then we had three more of our artists, Parvati, Padmapriya, and Revati, stayed back because we wanted to have a conversation because we don't see how else we're going to take this forward. And then they went and met them.
I think, I don't know if there are a lot of Malayalis here, you would have seen that press, you know, the press hung. Literally, it was like a 10-hour meeting. In between, unfortunately, Karuna Nadi passed away, and there were like so many things which happened at that day. And it was a fantabulous experience, actually, if you ask me, sir, you know, because for the first time, three of us who were part of an association were actually having a conversation with an executive committee, which had never happened before. And they were very supportive then. I think the biggest cheat point, which actually Rima missed out, was that they did not only bring the alleged actor who was, you know, allegedly accused, they brought him back without the notice and memory of any member of AMMA other than the executive committee. Forget about the entire executive committee, some members of the executive committee. So it's very interesting that they tried to do a hogwash, and in spite of very detailed legal documentation, and after 3 months, the floods happened, so we came out of the open. There's a document, you can visit our website, which was painstakingly made by me and Andrea and a few of us, which talks about the entire sequence of events and the way we have dealt with it. You'll realize that a lot of you, I don't know, are aware of the CGI case. I don't want to draw parallels, but literally in terms of course of justice, when it comes to gender issues, is never followed. The due process is never followed, and that's what we were questioning. And it's a sad truth that it can happen at the Chief Justice of India level. I mean, what's an AMMA? Yes, it's unfortunate, but yeah. There's where's the mic? Okay, we'll come to you, sir.
Hello, ma'am. Hi, sir. I really enjoyed the movie, and first of all, to the director, I was like, all the puns we used, the democracy, the Godse, which is really awesome. And the Gandhi that stood at the midnight, it was like standing event. It was really awesome. Two doubts actually I'll ask one by one. The first one is the Rima sits in a chair in front of the travel agency, and there is a handicapped guy who comes and sits by her. She gives him a smile, and then she just goes back. So I was a little confused there. So I don't know if I couldn't understand, like, what did you mean really there?
What actually you understood by seeing that? I'm asking you.
First, I got impression that they knew each other earlier, and then the bus that crosses her and it surpasses her.
Okay, no, I mean, they didn't know each other earlier, and they're seeing for the first time. And just like that, the character played by Rima is interested in that guy. So she's giving that look, you know, that interested look, you know, that look she's giving. It's a common thing, like, I mean, yeah. Malayalam parnal ellarum vaaya nokkuna aa oru saadharana. So that's just that, it's a common thing. Nokkanum ishtapettu veendum nokku. Kalangu vaadikku povu. Kada avathra maravadikku povu.
But why is there a differently able guy? That's what I was asking. Why is
why not a differently able guy?
Why
is
he some fun of
that's the point. He's saying, why not?
Why not a differently able guy? So that was purposeful. It's not that, you know, we wanted to cast someone and we found a differently able guy, so we cast it. No, it's not like that. It's purposeful that we casted someone who is differently able there.
Okay. My question is, you should, most of them are Malayalis, are traveling towards Kerala. So when the scene ends, they end to Kerala. The things are happening from Bangalore towards Tamil Nadu and then
right.
So why that journey from other states towards Kerala?
It's like you've seen the film, and the bus system is full in chaos, and now it's just reached Kerala. So the story just began. So it's like that. That's what I tried to put in. I mean, whatever you saw is like, you know, that's just entering Kerala. Just like you have the BJP entering Kerala.
I think this is. is a gentleman here. Yes. And while the mic is coming to you, you know, I just have a question, because we were talking about the difference between the Bollywood Me Too movement and the Women in Cinema Collective. And one thing that strikes me, Rima, is that the Me Too movement in Bollywood started with the small fry. With all due respect to Alok Nath and all, they are still marginal characters, players in the Hindi film industry. Whereas with the Malayalam film industry, WCC, it started out with one of the biggest superstars that you were up against. Do you think that you have lasted for 2 years? Because that was like, I mean, how much worse could it get? That you are dealing with a crime allegedly committed against your co-star by one of the biggest stars in the industry. So all the opposition that you could possibly face has been faced in your first battle. So how much do you think that has contributed to the fact that you've lasted?
No, it did have quite a lot of traction in India and all over the state and even outside the state, because you know the names associated with that big. Yes, that is true, Anna, but then I think WCC has lasted this long because even after that, we had so many actresses. I think this is the biggest achievement that we have had, you know, by just existing, is that new actresses who have maybe, like, who's doing their first film too, you know, who are hardly there, known yet, find it safe to approach us when they have an issue. I didn't have that. You didn't have that, Priya. We didn't have that. So today, we're just 20 women, powerless, power, I don't care. But they actually talk to us, they call us, they try to reach us. They tell us we have an issue. And they actually, even if they don't see solution to it, they know we are there. I think that's, I mean, I would have loved to have somebody like that to reach out to when I came into the industry. I really didn't. So I think that is why we are still around. I think we right now we're dealing with a new actress who had an issue on the sets of her new movie, where she was, again, you know, physically assaulted by the stunt director. And we're in talks with FEFCA, and they, in the beginning, they would brush us aside, they would make us wait. But now, they actually sit up and they say, we will look into it right away. I think that's it. That's a major shift. That's a major shift. Major shift.
Where's the mic?
Yeah. Yes. So through this bus journey in this movie, you have successfully captured, you know, almost thousands of moods, subjects, topics which concern not just Keralites, but, you know, all Indians. And very successfully and beautifully captured, including the police and so many other issues. So, congratulations for that. And my question is, the choice of the name of the bus agency, Democracy, of course, it's the most striking one. And this is, was it the first choice, or did you fiddle with some other names also? And what were the other names that you fiddled with them?
That's what I told before. This idea began with another short film called Democracy to Each His Own. So, democracy was the, you know, central theme. I mean, the whole story evolved around it. So there was no other options. It was democracy. Thanks.
Where's my?
Can I speak in Malayalam, because I am more comfortable in Malayalam?
Sure. Okay. And I will try and translate for those who aren't conversant with Malayalam.
Okay, so WCC നടത്തിയ ഇന്റർവ്യൂ അതുപോലെ പിന്നീട് അമ്മ AMMA നേതൃത്വത്തിൽ നടത്തിയ ഇന്റർവ്യൂ തമ്മിലുള്ള ഒരു വ്യത്യാസം കാണുന്നു. അത് കുറെ പെണ്ണുങ്ങൾ ഇരുന്ന് സംസാരിക്കുമ്പോൾ അവരുടെ ആശയങ്ങൾ പറയുമ്പോൾ ഒരുമാതിരി കടിച്ചുകയറാമായിരുന്നു പറയുന്നു റെസ്പോൺസസ് കാര്യങ്ങളായിരുന്നു. കാര്യങ്ങൾ നിന്ന് അവതരിപ്പിക്കാൻ ഒരു കാര്യം പൂർണ്ണമായിട്ട് പറയാൻ വേണ്ടി ഒരുപാട് ബുദ്ധിമുട്ടുന്നുണ്ടായിരുന്നു ആളുകൾ. പക്ഷെ അതേസമയം പിന്നീട് AMMA ഒരു മീറ്റിംഗ് വരുമ്പോൾ വളരെ കാം ക്വയറ്റ് വളരെ ഒരു ഫാമിലി പരിപാടിയൊക്കെ നടക്കുന്ന പോലെ എന്തെങ്കിലും ചോദ്യമുണ്ടോ മക്കളെ എന്നുള്ള ചോദിക്കുന്ന ഒരു ഫീലിംഗ് ആയിരുന്നു അവിടെ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നത്. ഞാൻ വിശ്വസിക്കുന്നത് അതെന്തായാലും ആ ഒരു സ്റ്റാർഡം അവിടെ പ്രസിഡന്റ് ആയിട്ടിരിക്കുന്ന ആ ആളുടെ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ കുറച്ച് മെയിൽ ആക്ടേഴ്സിന്റെ അവരുടെ ഒരു സ്റ്റാർഡും കൊണ്ട് തന്നെയാണ് ആ ഒരു കീപ് ആൻഡ് കാം അറ്റ്മോസ്ഫിയർ അവർക്ക് അവിടെ കിട്ടിയത്, നിങ്ങൾക്ക് കിട്ടാതെ പോയത്. അതേപോലെ തന്നെ പലപ്പോഴും പാർവതി ആയിക്കോട്ടെ ഒരു കസബയെ പറ്റി പറഞ്ഞപ്പോൾ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഒരു പരിശ്രമീനെ പറ്റി പറഞ്ഞപ്പോൾ വെർബൽ ഡ്രൈപ്പിംഗ് കൊണ്ട് അമ്മാനോടിയതും എല്ലാം കുറെ ഫാൻസ് ഗ്രൂപ്പിൻ്റെ ഒക്കെ നേതൃത്വത്തിലും അത് ഈവൻ ഈ പടത്തിന്റെ ട്രെയിലർ എടുത്തു നോക്കിയാൽ തന്നെ അതിൽ അടികിട്ടി വീഴുന്ന സീൻ ഉണ്ടല്ലോ, റിമ അടികിട്ടി വീഴുന്ന സീനിന്റെ താഴെ ട്രെയിലറിന്റെ താഴെ വന്നിട്ട് ഒരുപാട് കമന്റ്സ് ഉണ്ട്. ആ അവളുടെ മുഖത്ത് അടികിട്ടുന്ന കാണുമ്പോൾ എനിക്കൊരു സുഖമുണ്ടെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഒരുപാട് മലയാളികൾ വന്നിട്ട് കമന്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോ ഇതൊക്കെ വരുന്നത് ഇവർക്കുള്ള എന്തോ ഒരു സ്റ്റാർഡം ആ ഒരു താരം എന്നുള്ള ഇതിൽ നിന്നാണെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നുണ്ട്. അപ്പോ WCCA പോലെയുള്ള ഇങ്ങനെ ഒരു സംഘടന വരുന്ന സമയത്ത് കുറച്ച് മാറ്റങ്ങൾ വന്നുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്ന സമയത്ത് വീണ്ടും ആദ്യം നിങ്ങൾ ഒരു സർവേ പറഞ്ഞ സപ്പോർട്ട് പറഞ്ഞുകൊണ്ടിരുന്ന ഒരാൾ തന്നെ വീണ്ടും ഈ സ്റ്റാർട്ടപ്പ് സെലിബ്രേറ്റ് ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ട് ലൂസിഫർ പോലെയുള്ള ഒരു പടം പുറത്തിറക്കുമ്പോൾ ഇത് മോഹൻലാലിനെ ഫാൻസ് കാണാൻ ഇഷ്ടപ്പെടുന്ന രീതിയിൽ ഇറക്കാനാണ് ഞാൻ ആഗ്രഹിക്കുന്നതെന്ന് ഡയറക്ടർ പൃഥ്വിരാജ് ജനക് പറയുമ്പോൾ അഭിനയിക്കുന്ന മോഹൻലാലിന് ഇത് എന്നെ ആളുകൾ കാണാൻ ഇഷ്ടപ്പെടുന്ന രീതിയിലാണ് എന്ന് വെച്ചാൽ മീശ വിരിക്കലും ഉണ്ടും വളക്കി കൂത്തൽ നായിക വന്നിട്ട് മാപ്പിക്കൽ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ സഹായിച്ചു വിരിക്കലേക്ക് ഇതൊക്കെ തന്നെയാണെന്ന്
സോറി.
സോ അപ്പോ ആ തരത്തില് ലൂസിഫർ പോലുള്ള പടങ്ങൾ വീണ്ടും ബ്ലോക്ക്ബസ്റ്റർ ഹിറ്റ് ആവുന്നു. അപ്പൊ അത് ഈ WCCA വർക്കിനെ ഒരു സ്ലോ ഡൗൺ ചെയ്യുന്നത് പോലെ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ എന്താണ് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ചെയ്യാനുള്ളത് അത് സ്ലോ ഡൗൺ ചെയ്യുന്ന പോലെ തോന്നില്ലേ? ഒന്ന് സോറി ഫോർ ബീയിങ് സോ ലോങ്.
I think my Malayalam is not as good as it should be, but I think basically what you're saying is that there is the male stars that have that are the male stars of Amma are really 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 major stars like Mohanlal and Mammootty and all of them. And is it that when the media, when you talk of meetings, you're talking about the media, right? Is she talking about the media? Yeah, so when the media confronts Amma, there is a certain calm and respect, and they seem to be starstruck while they're asking questions to the media, whereas when they speak to the WCC, they're far more aggressive. So that's one question, is that true? And B, the second question is that, just for some background, Prithviraj Sukumaran was one of the actors who was very supportive of the WCC when they started out. And then recently he made a film with Mohanlal, and Mohanlal has not been as supportive of the WCC as you would imagine. But you know, again, Mohanlal's a major star. Prithviraj has a lot to gain from working with Mohanlal. So this entire power dynamic, I think the question is whether how this entire power dynamic and the stardom of the male stars that are not standing by the women of the Women in Cinema Collective, how is WCC dealing with that, and how is it affecting you? Funny.
I think two things you asked. One is why the media was very lenient towards the male stars, the Amma news conference versus us, that they were very they were on an attacking mode. I think first and foremost it's the combination actor plus male is actor female. The female is underlined with like no red marker there, you know, when women are speaking up, I don't think anybody takes it lightly. I don't think on the whole, we're standing on the very strong platform of cinema and questioning patriarchy and the system. And they know all the women out there are listening to this, and they don't want all the women out there and in their homes standing up and talking like us, I guess. I don't know. Okay, that's one. The next one, you were asking Lucifer, like a movie like Lucifer winning big time, does it affect our movement? I think at the same time, a movie like Kumbhalangi Nights, which outright questions patriarchy in a commercial format, has the audience for those kind of movies have grown big time. I know because, you know, my friends produced the movie, and I know that it's big. The audience have really grown, they have changed, they have started questioning on behalf of us. That's the best thing about our audience, about the Kerala audience.
And also, let's not forget Uyere, which is right now.
Yes, it's
in its third week in the National Capital Region and is in its fourth week in Kerala. And it's got Parvati.
Yes.
And the same Parvati who was abused for criticizing Kasaba. So take that.
Yeah, you know, I really, really feel, or to all the trolls that we get online, I think that's just a bunch of people, mostly paid, who are sitting and copying these comments that they get through their WhatsApp groups. But the other side of the spectrum, who really want to support us, go take a ticket and watch our movies. That's all we need.
I think it was the gentleman here who raised his hand, the one in the green shirt. And then, sir, we will come to you. I know you were the first to raise your hand.
Could you collect questions, 2-3 maybe, and then look at
it? Okay.
One question to the ladies. This group of yours is now almost 2 years old, and you've grown from strength to strength. How come still there are guys who have the guts to, molest women on stage or during the production stage, and things like this continue to happen? I would have thought people would have got smarter and sensible and, avoid such things. From happening,
yeah,
getting
it's
involved in such stuff.
I think it's, we have women professionals, not just actresses, we have hairdressers too, ADs who call us up and tell us that the environment that they're working in has changed, that people are afraid or scared, or they would think twice before doing anything that they wouldn't even have thought of before. I think that's a marked change, but then let us also understand that all these women come from a very strong conditioned background, where they are from a very young age told that they're voiceless and what they feel and what they deserve is nothing, that the voices don't matter. So until and unless, like our friend who stood up and spoke, I really don't know how many women are in a position to do that. Even if they are courageous enough, and even if they really want to, there's anger, they might really need the job. You can't judge them. They might really be in a position where they don't feel powerful enough. Maybe that's where we are lacking. Maybe that's where we have to help them out more. I think it's a process. It's just been 2 years, give us more time.
I think an extension of that point is the simple fact that there's, in spite of having a law, blah, 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 there's still no framework for protection and promotion of the women's interests, especially safety, from a safety point of view. So the PIL, the public interest litigation, which WCC has filed against the entire Malayalam film industry, the kind of responses you get back, in spite of the fact that there's some ecosystem of fear, there's also an ecosystem of, okay, so what? There is no system, there's no punishment. What is it that I'm going to really face, right? So the responses to a public interest litigation saying please implement an act which has been passed in 2015 and has a history of 15 years is that we as WCC are doing it for publicity. So I think it is, please understand, it's just 2 years, and the system has been here for at least 70 years. So like fighting something like this would be very revolutionary steps. And to that extent, some of the things which we do apart from a writ petition is trying to make Bina Paul is like leading a activity called the Gender Manual, which is like a collaborative practice with people from all industries to try and figure what's good practice, right? What's gender inclusion means? It's not just about us going and finding a press conference and saying, as what we pointed out. So I think it has to be a combination of a lot of things. Rima has been managing this the entire what's her name? The entire film festival thing. So, we've kind of screened a lot of films with people. These are not things which actually come out with Archana Padmini, another one of the WCC members.
We're also working to constitute an ICC on every film set where, a woman can anonymously come and register a complaint.
This is the implementation of the act. But really the response to the writ petition, which is in the public interest of everybody, is that one is doing this for publicity. Why would a constitution enact an act which is being done by publicity by women? But yeah, clearly, I think it'll take a while, but all of these things put together will probably make a change.
First thing for the director, the ending of the movie, I like the way you showed the battlefields to show whoever should the real fight be happening. But I was thinking, do we really have to wait for the Maoists to come and smash back there?
They're not Maoists.
No, no, I'm asking, like, is that what you referred to? When they had to come here to smash back there? Is that what you intended?
No, not really. See, how do you classify a Maoist?
Not a clear reference that they were Maoist.
Even people who claim, who point to someone and say that guy is a Maoist, does the guy who is speaking or the guy who is pointed at know who is Mao?
No, I'm not going to the politics, but I was just thinking.
Means that, Maoist is a common term point to actually point at an extremist, even though they don't have any idea who is a Maoist.
I'm not negatively saying it, I'm saying that, is that you are a...
In fact, the film ended when you have the black screen and the laugh in the background. There the film ended. And the next is like the title thing, which I want to make it like that. The film actually ended there. And Suraj, we have already portrayed Suraj as someone who's not afraid of the police. And he can make up stories and, find his way around. And the only people he's afraid of in this whole movie is those two people who are pointed to be the Maoists. So that's just the ending pattern. No other extra
intentions
on this.
Right?
We are not showing a situation where it, the extremists are...
No, I don't mind them taking on pattern.
I
have a question regarding
that. One more thing. We also wanted to end that sequence where the violence will not yield any result. It goes to the end of all three people. That's how we end the whole sequence.
It's 2 years of WCC. My question is that how are you dealing with the questions of intersectionality within the movement? Portrayal of Dalit women in the Malayalam cinema or Muslim women. So how is the movement considering it? Especially, you had a lot of meetings and discussions over it. Especially, we have a history of P.K. Rosi. The history itself of Malayalam cinema is that of...
Thank you. While you answer the question, Sachin, I think there's one last person somewhere in the shadows at the back. Okay, so you answer the question and Sachin, you can run with the mic to one person.
This one is going to be a quick one because when Nina Paul was trying to organize this conference, the first of the conferences for the gender manual, we were trying to get as many representative voices, not just women, but various kinds of intersectionalities. Unfortunately, the representation of women is so less. Imagine the representation of the intersectionalities, right? The numbers. So actually there was a Dalit female activist who said, oh, you don't have these people coming. And we said, where are they? Because if we can't find the woman, where are we going to find the intersectionalities? It's not like we don't want to address it. But of course, there are ways in which it will get addressed through the entire process. And I think once you start talking about the marginalized, whether it's a woman, automatically, then naturally the question of the other areas of marginalization come on. So it's a natural process. It's not something which is categorical and straight jacketed. Nice. That answers your question.
And, okay. I should also say that the only Dalit filmmaker, female filmmaker that we know, Jeeva, and a tribal female filmmaker, Leela Santosh, is part of WCC.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
there
are just two of them.
Part of this festival.
Yeah. Part of this festival. Oh, yes, Jeeva's movie showing. You should take a look at it. It's wonderful.
Okay, so you have a question. Kuti Jodhya. Just before, Rima just mentioned that when female artists are coming to the film industry, they are coming at a very young age and they don't have the courage to speak up. So, when we also see most of the female artists, they come at the age of between 15 to 20.
means just after their 10th or plus 2. So how you feel, how education can give more confidence for women in industry? How do you feel, how much education should an artist have? How I feel that education
is... I think it's not really education, I think it's age, right? We all kind of figure out stuff and we know more and we understand things better and better.
And that education applies to men as well.
Yeah, it's not just the women, I guess.
Okay, we're taking the last question, and that's the gentleman in the shadow.
Good question, good question.
I think you need to be sad for a very long time. As far as actors, artists are concerned. We can address this later.
Okay, but while we just before you ask your question, I have a question on education because, you know, the three of you will, I don't know if you've noticed this because you're so close to the Malayalam film industry, but the one thing I see that's the difference between the women of WCC and all, pretty much all the women I meet from the Hindi film industry is that the women of the Hindi film industry join the industry really early, and a woman with a college degree or any, you know, any college education is very rare in the Hindi film industry among actresses. Like a Vidya Balan, very rare. I was looking at the backgrounds, Swara, very rare. I was looking at the back, and you know how vocal Swara and Vidya both are. I was looking at the backgrounds of the founder members of the WCC, and I was startled because, you know, there's like double MA, like MA and all is not a big deal among them. And MA in the Hindi film industry for a woman is very rare. So, I mean, I know we're going through a phase where education is being dissed and we have a top leader saying hard work and not Harvard and rubbish like that. But how important has this education been in giving you the confidence to go forward with WCC?
I kind of really disagree because the survivor whom we are talking about is a 10 plus. She graduated from a 10th class and literally joined the film industry. So I really think that the deep gut instinct, of course I fought in a long, you know, I've had 2-3 fights. I've been banned by the industry multiple times. Right, like from Tamil to Malayalam. And still I have stood back and I've gotten offers and I that's probably because of the work ethos I get, right? I really don't know. I think the audacity to stand up for your values and your moral system is beyond just education. It's about our societal makeup and what we stand for. We were so many educated women. When we met for Katan Chaya, the first time we realized we were very disempowered women.
Yeah.
We were very disempowered women. Maybe because we, like both myself and Rima, had fought enough cases that we think, kuch nahi ho sakta. You know, so I'm not disqualifying education. I'm probably over-educated. I'm more educated than my husband. I still can't stop going to school. But, you know, that's not the reason why you stand out. You stand up because of the value system and your ability to stand up for that value system.
Okay, that's the last question over there. Yes,
sir. There's one topic on which your world becomes total bodies. The movie, a lot about God. You didn't have any issue with the dialogues, you know, we're talking about Virgin Mary, IFN, and criticizing. These days, you know, you say anything, you get attacked or, you go to one side. You didn't find any issues with the audience or somebody criticizing you?
Lots of. In fact, we got censor certificate for this film after fighting for 6 months. First in Kerala, then in Mumbai, and finally a special court in Delhi. So, 6 months of fighting, and that's how we got the censor certificate. There are like 4 or 5 dialogues already cut in the version you've seen. So, yeah, we managed to, just manage 5 cuts and get through.
Okay, I know that there are many other people who want to ask questions. I'm sorry, we have to finish. I want to thank all of you for being here because your presence here is also solidarity. I want to thank and congratulate Rima and Padmapriya because your persistence is more inspiring to the rest of us women than you can possibly imagine. I want to thank Jubith because, like I said, as women feminists, we depend on the support of our gentlemen feminist friends. And I think that the support you provided to Ms. Gopinath in the face of an issue she had with Alencia, who is an artist that I at one time greatly respected for his off-screen activities also and his politics,
hats off to you for that. So thank you for that. And India Habitat Center, it is not easy to have a platform in Delhi where we're talking about any film industry other than Bollywood. But India Habitat Center, I can see Sachin over here. I cannot see anybody else. But I just dropped Sachin a mail saying, Sachin, can you do something at the festival for WCC? And that was it. That's the only thing I did. And he has spent the past 2 months ensuring that he gets these three people here on stage and publicizing this event. And the fact that we have this event in Delhi, which is not Bollywood obsessed, because Bollywood doesn't need publicity, the national media is giving them enough. But the fact that Habitat is providing this platform is a very big thing. So thank you so much, Sachin, too. Good night. Thank you all. Thank you.